Hello again. In the previous video, I looked a little bit at putting together the basic structure of models, in particular trying to look at structures and component lists. That video ran a little long, so I broke it, and I thought I'd set up a second one. Now I'm going to look at, again, component lists, string sets, structures, particularly looking at putting together a quick reaction model. Okay, so from the previous video, you will have seen me setting up the stream list, my port, and the holdup model, and I've created structures for my properties. Sorry, that was the port was here. And that was the structure for the properties that I set up. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to create, I'm going to demonstrate inheritance and create a reactor model. So if you remember, the holdup model had the equations for d by dt is in minus out plus reaction, but I've just fixed the reaction rates all at zero and not done anything with them. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to create a new model, let's call it React, and what I'm going to do with this reaction model is use the holdup. So uses holdup is all I need to do for that. If I compile that, you see that compiles and it's happy. And if I bring one of these React models onto the flow sheet, it's got all the same variables and underneath it all the same equations as the tank model does. So on its own, it's not very interesting. So let's add some reaction parameters. I've written those up. So what I'm going to do first off is I'm going to define a couple of string sets. And again, I've written the text over here to save you having to watch me type it all out. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a string set that I'm going to call reacting. That's going to be the components involved in the reaction, and I'm going to say A, B, and C are involved in the reaction. D, which is the fourth component in my my setup, is not going to be involved in the reaction. It's just going to be floating around as a independent component, not doing anything in the reaction. Okay, so I've got three reacting components, and then I'm going to have two reactions, one which is I'm going to call production, and one I'm going to call decay. So I'm going to have A goes to B as production, B goes to C as decay. Really complicated and interesting model that you have. I'm going to define some Arrhenius kinetics. So to do that, again, what I'm going to do is have an activation energy, a pre-exponential constant, an Arrhenius activation energy, stoichiometry for the reaction, which is going to be a 2D array. So the reaction parameters defined based on the reaction. So for the production reaction, I've got one. For the decay reaction, I've got another. And then the stoichiometry for each reaction, and then for each reacting component. So that's a 2D array that's going to take care of that. And then just because of the way I like to write equations, I'm going to go with a reference temperature of 50 C, as opposed to the traditional Arrhenius, which would take it back to the reaction rate at zero Kelvin. If for later on when I'm going to show some data regression, it makes it easier to do data regression if you recenter the reaction system. And then finally, I've defined my reaction constants, which I'm going to define based on those. Okay, so let's put in those equations. Again, I'm going to steal some text that I wrote earlier. So here's my array for each of the reactions. I'm saying K for reaction I is Kref e to the minus Ea over RT adjusted for my reference temperature. So that's my rate of reaction. Let's get excited and come in and say, I'm going to give myself some starting conditions for those rates of reaction and the rate of formation. So that's that section. Okay, now let's write equations for the actual reaction rates. So there we go. I've got some reaction rates, and I guess I have to define those variables as well. So let's do that. So I've defined my reaction rates, and I've got my temperature. And then finally, I'm going to throw in my stoichiometry equations to actually having freed my rate of reaction for the reacting components. I'm then going to say for each of those, the rate of reaction is the sum of the stoichiometric coefficient times that rate of reaction. And this is kind of cute because it's sort of showing how to do a 2D array and how to reference 2D arrays. So what I'm doing is I'm using sigma, and then I'm using an array within the sigma. So for each j in the reactions, I'm going to use the stoichiometry of j and the reaction of j, and then for each I in the reacting components, that's going to define the rate at which I'm creating I and the stoichiometric coefficient for that. So there's my reaction complete. The key things, hopefully, that you're picking up here is I can define reaction sets, I can create variables based on those reaction sets, on those string sets, and then I can use elements of those string sets to write arrays in 1 or 2D to do those reactions. So let's write that. That looks like it works. Let's throw that reactor onto my stream table, onto my flow sheet rather. So I've got a reactor, I've got a stream flowing into it. Once again, I'm 1 degree of freedom underspecified because of the way I wrote the tank, because it has a different structure in steady state versus dynamic. What I'm going to do initially is I'm going to fix its mass in steady state. So now I've got 1,000 kilos an hour of D, the non-reactive component, flowing through the system. I've got a tank volume of 10 kilos, so I'm blowing material through there very quickly. You see I've initialized my tank with all D, and so we're all nicely set up. So if what I want to do instead is to have a 50-50 mixture of A and D, I can do that. Now you can see that I start off with almost 50% of A. My reactions are turning on, so my rates of reaction, that's down here, made. You can see I'm consuming A, I'm making a little bit of B, and then the C is not being made hardly at all. So that's the reactions are happening in my system. It's all nicely set up. So that's good. Okay, so that's great. If I have a single reactor, that's probably all I need to do. I've got my rate constants embedded within the reactor, and that's all nice. But again, if I have multiple reactors that are going to use the same set of components or the same reaction set, what I need to do is, well, what I could do is hide all this stuff into a structure. So let me do that. Let me, once again, just to reiterate how to make the structures, I come over here, I add a structure, I'm going to call it react reaction, so that I can differentiate it from my properties. And what I'm going to do is basically I'm going to steal that text from the top of the reactor model. So you've got the equations and their initial conditions there. And you'll see that, that is basically the same as the top part of the React model. So really I've just transferred a bunch of stuff from here to there. So compile, make sure that that works. You see it's compiled with no errors, so that's good. So now what I want to do is rewrite my reactor model. So essentially what I can do is I can delete all this stuff, because that's going to be declared somewhere else. I can delete this stuff, because that's going to be declared somewhere else. Then what I want to do is create an instance of that reaction system. So first off, I come back over here, I create an instance of the reaction, and I'm going to call it, my react. So you can see that then creates in the structures my react, and I've got my numbers and defaults in the my react area. So what I can do then is I can take that array declaration, that structure declaration across into my reactor model. So that's there. Now, because I've taken the reactions up to the structure, what I've got to do is I've got to come through and move all this stuff down a level. So the reactions are now a component in the React structure. And so I can go through and make all those changes. So why don't I just do that here rather than messing about? It's same, but reacting is now in and reactions are now in the submodel. So I think that should now compile. Nope, I missed something. Ah, yes, my kref, ea over rt, and tref are all in my submodel. And so is my stoichiometry. There you go. So now it's all good. So what I've done is I've moved those variables up to the structure. And again, like with the properties, if I want to use the same reaction system in a different part of the model, having them in a structure means that I'm going to use the same values and the same structure consistently throughout the system. And that's going to prevent me from making a silly mistake later on. Okay, so there's my system all nicely set up. It's converging in steady state. I've got the same reaction rates and behavior. You see I've got fewer variables here because I've moved those up to the structure. If I want to change my rate constant, I can now only do it in one place. It's up here at the structure level. And so those variables have moved from this table on the all variables of B4 to here on the structures, so that if I have a second reactor, I use the same reaction constants in all those reactors, which makes sense, I hope. Okay, so that's that. You've got a steady state model. One thing that might be kind of interesting is to set the system up and have a look at it as a batch reaction. So one other thing I'm going to do, which is kind of a nice cute little cheat, is I'm going to come in and I'm actually going to create a logical variable, a logical parameter, I should say, called isReacting. And using that, I'm going to determine whether or not the reactions actually happen. And again, here's some code that I prepared earlier. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to say, if isReacting is true, then I have the same equation as I had before. Otherwise, k is equal to 0. If k is equal to 0, none of the reactions are happening, and the whole system shuts down. What that's going to let me do is let's come back over here to my steady state. Let's have 1,000 kilograms of material in my tank. Let's set isReacting to false. And so what you should see is that these reactions all go to 0. And they don't go to completely 0. And again, that is in the same way you remember I wanted to rewrite that sum of the holdup to be forcing it to 1. What's happening is it's solving to within the numerical tolerance. The numerical tolerance is 10 to the minus 6. So this is less than 10 to the minus 6, which then ACM assumes is the same as 0, which is a bit frustrating, but that's the joy of numerical methods, I'm afraid. Okay, so I've got now a reactor that's set up. I've got no reactions happening. I've got a nice steady state model, though, where I've got a tank full of A. So let's now have some fun. Let's turn this into a dynamic model. Let's turn those reactions back on again. Is reacting back to true. And then because I want to have this set up as a batch reactor, what I'm going to do is I'm going to free the mass and I'm going to fix the flow out. I'm going to fix that outlet flow at 0. And just to make it an interesting batch, I'm going to fix the flow in to 0. And then finally, let's create a plot called concentrations. And I'm going to have a look at the concentration of A, B, and C. Let's do all of them, A, B, C, and D, as a function of time. And then what I want to do, clicking in the area of the graph, I'm going to go to the properties of the graph, I'm going to go to the axis map, and I'm going to put all of them on the same axis so that they're all on the same concentration basis. And then let's let the reaction rip. And you can see A is being consumed, B is being produced, D is doing nothing at all. And then as the concentration of B starts to pick up, you'll see the concentration of C build. You can see the model is running relatively slowly. By default, ACM has a tiny communication interval. If I make that communication interval smaller, the model will run a lot faster. And so now you can see I've peaked in terms of B. B is quite large. Now I'm starting to form some C, and I've consumed all of my A. So there you go. A goes to B, goes to C. Not perhaps the most exciting model, but hopefully it demonstrates, again, reinforces structures, string sets, and those sort of things. Again, the string set, I could have, if I'd chosen to do it differently, I could have made the reacting array rather than a string set, I could have made that a component list, and then I could have changed what my reactions were in different parts of the model. But typically, I want it to be constant, so it seemed like a smarter move in this case to make it a string set. I've got 2D arrays. I've got stuff being moved up. I'm setting default values for non-standard components up at that structure level. So that's what I wanted to show you. Nice quick one. Thank you very much for your attention. Again, if you like it, say so. If you have any comments or questions, I'll try and answer them or respond to them. Thank you. Bye.